Who would have thought you and I would end up in New York, Richard Quest? I mean, you think it's baffling enough that I am. I feel the same way about you.
When you came and walked into this building, what did you think? And you saw what you were about to undertake.
I was always quite intoxicated by the whole concept of CNN. Even from when I was working in British newspapers and remembered the 91 Gulf War when CNN made its name. It just seemed so incredibly exciting, breaking news, to be the place that was about breaking news.
On gun control in the United States, you refer in the book, to, you say, when there'd been the shopping mall shooting in Oregon, you said, this is happening all the time. When will anyone do anything about it? Why did you think it was your role to be the person who was going to carry the call?
Well, because primarily I'd been down this road before. I'd seen this movie, and it was Dunblane in Scotland. And anyone who was involved in covering that, as I was, remembers 16 kids, aged 5 years old, blown to pieces in a school shooting. And what was fascinating with the parallels to Sandy Hook, which came just after that Oregon shooting, were you had virtually the same number of children, same kind of age, all killed by a lone shooter. But in Britain, the left and right on the political divide came together, the media came together, the public came together, and draconian gun control was introduced, which has been indisputably incredibly successful.
You and I are roughly the same age. I'm a bit older.
Are we really?
I'm a bit older.
Good Lord,
I'm a bit older.
At least a decade difference.
No,
much as, word for it.
Much as you'd like to believe that. We've both had to learn to tweet. You've been much more successful at it than I have, but we've both had to do it with a certain avarice and purpose. Yeah. Not because we particularly want to, but because that's the way you communicate.
I was always the anti-tweet guy. I couldn't understand what Twitter was. It seemed a ridiculous, vacuous waste of time. And then I remember being in this office and a guy called Steve Cracker, who was my digital producer, came and said, you've got to get involved in this. This is before we went on air. He said, because if you do and it really takes off, you could have a huge follower count. And if you have that, that can drive ratings. And there was a moment about 2 months later when I interviewed Charlie Sheen at the peak of his powers. And I sent one tweet about Charlie Sheen saying, in 5 minutes' time, change the schedule, Charlie Sheen live for the hour. When we got the ratings back, the ratings leapt 500,000 in those 5 minutes.
There was a quote in the book on ratings when there was a blip, a bad blip.
Terrible, horrendous.
You came in and you saw the blip and you quote, I felt physically sick. Genuinely, I wanted to go into my office, lock this office. Let's hope you didn't.
Yeah.
Lock the door and puke in the trash can.
I did it right in that chair. That's how I felt. I mean, it reminded me of the worst days of being at the Daily Mirror when you would, for no apparent reason, have this calamitous rating and you would spend hours, as I did with this one, self-analyzing. Where did we go wrong? There'd be no apparent clue. It was a normal show, normal night. And then slowly but surely you piece together the reality. We had aired an interview with Jane Lynch from Glee by complete accident up against Glee itself.
What have you got up here?
Well, these are some of my my interviews. Oprah, the very first interview there. Supposed to give me 40 minutes, gave me 2 hours. Could not have been more delightful. My kids here. People say, oh, your kids, you know, they obviously, they must miss you. And I say, yeah, but look what happens when they come to America. There's my oldest boy with Beyonce, where she's leaning in as if somehow she's the crazed fan. That goes on his Facebook page, and I buy myself another month of absentee fatherism.
Will it be another 3 years?
Well, some people have described me as the Samuel Pepys of the modern era with my diaries. Others have been less kind. I simply record these in diary format because I think people, when they read through it, can live themselves what they went through and perhaps get a perspective from somebody who has got a lot of opinions. I don't expect you to agree with a lot of them, but I do expect to try and stir debate. And I would love to be at CNN in 3 years' time doing another book about whatever's happened in that period, because I can't think of a more engrossing time to be at the center of world affairs right here in New York in America, where you just feel, and I'm sure you feel the same way, that economically and in terms of superpower status and everything, this may be the most challenging period America's ever faced.